It's another edition of Time About the Movies, and today we're taking a look at the films of August 4th, 1995. We got six movies to look at, so let's just jump on into it. Let's start off with the biggest new release of the weekend, and that is Dennis Quaid and Julia Roberts starring in the romantic comedy Something to Talk About.
For Grace, life was good. She had a successful career, a beautiful daughter, and a loving husband. Until one day...
God, help me. Eddie! I can see you!
Hi, Daddy, yeah.
At this time, I open the floor to any new business.
Yes, I would just like to know if anybody else here has slept with my husband.
Right. Is there anyone who, for any reason, has had any kind of sex with my damn husband? I think I have a right to know.
Grace, just making out count.
I mean, what in the name of God's gotten into you?
Daddy.
Can you try to humiliate your whole family?
The world is he thinking about? Probably the same thing he was thinking with.
Warner Brothers presents an extraordinary motion picture about a woman confronted with a fact she can't accept.
You don't know what it's like to be sitting there with your child while your husband is making out with someone on the street.
Sometimes a man doesn't know the value of what he's got until he's lost it. You follow what I'm getting at?
A truth she can't escape.
Remember how we used to make each other laugh? You ever wonder if we can ever get back to that?
And a chance she can't resist.
Let's feel this right now.
No, Eddie, this isn't funny. You
won't believe Julia Roberts. Robert Duvall. Jenna Rollins. Kira Sedgwick. And Dennis Quaid. Something to Talk About.
You know, there's so much talent involved with this movie, not just on screen, but also behind the scenes. And you have Lassie Hallström, who had just done What's Eating Gilbert Grape. You have Callie Curie, whose first movie she ever wrote and directed, Thelma and Louise, turned out to be a big hit 4 years prior to this. And actually, I found it very interesting that this is only the second of three films she's ever written. Like, she did Thelma and Louise, this movie, and then she wrote Respect with the Aretha Franklin movie. But she also only directed three films, Divine Sequels to the Aliyah Sisterhood, Mad Money, and Patsy and Loretta, all of those movies she didn't write. So found that very interesting, even though she's been a prolific writer for so many years. Like, you've seen her name before on various projects, but only six movies to her name, honestly. But going back to this movie, you have so much talent there behind the scenes, on screen, Julia Roberts, Dennis Quaid, Robert Duvall, Kira Sedgwick, Jenna Rollins. Just a really good cast overall, but at the same time, though, this movie just can't get away from the fact that it's basically a lackluster TV movie of the week. Like, this is something that looks like it would be seen on Lifetime or the Hallmark Channel. Just a movie that just feels very generic, and everybody acts like typical old-fashioned idiots in those movies. Like, they just see something like this, and they just say, oh, just let it slide. Like, the whole thing in this movie is that Julia Roberts' husband cheats on her, and everybody in this town is just like, you know what, just let it go. I mean, what's the worst thing that could happen to you? Well, you got a kid with him, too, so that's something that you have to deal with here. And, like, it'd be something if the story was actually very interesting or these characters were interesting, but these characters are not interesting whatsoever. I mean, Julia Roberts doesn't usually pick a lot of bad movies, but when she picks bad films, she picks some really, really bad movies. And this is one that's just like, it just feels like a movie that, it's like those movies that I really hate, those romantic comedies that don't really rely on too much comedy. The comedy isn't really like, I've talked about my whole thing about comedies, that misery is the main concept of what makes comedy so special and so funny. And this is one of those movies that just feels like that they don't buy into that whatsoever. The comedy is that, hey, let's just talk. Let's just say, and let's not say anything that's even remotely funny, except for the older 40-year-old women who are going to be watching this movie repeatedly when it appears on Lifetime in about 2 years. And it's just like, there's no real fun to this movie whatsoever. It's a boring, boring movie. There's nothing interesting about these characters whatsoever. There's no funny comedy in it. There's nothing really all that interesting or exciting going on. It's just a bland movie with so much talent involved in here. I mean, Goldie Hawn's a producer on this movie. Like, you would think there'd be so much more with this, but it's just a generic movie. It's nothing interesting whatsoever. It's one of those movies that Julia Roberts picks where she is kind of obligated to star in it because she's a big star and people will go see it, but she knows this movie's probably not that great. Like I said before, she doesn't usually pick bad movies, but when she picks bad movies, she picks really, really bad movies. Eat, Pray, Love is the best example of that, so... not much more to say about this one, but something to talk about is nothing that you want to talk about after it's done. Why don't we go to a much better movie that came out this weekend, probably the best movie that came out this weekend, period, and that is, of course, Babe.
When I first came to the boss's farm, it was a whole new world to me. Everyone here seemed to know their place. The boss and his wife, the sheepdogs, the sheep, and all the other animals. Well, almost.
We've got to do something about that duck.
Now I just have to figure out where I fit in.
I want my mom.
Good heavens. Who are you?
Babe.
There. The little pig's a bit low. He's going to sleep with us.
But, Mom, he went to bed.
What are you?
You.
Pig. What are you?
I'm a you. A you.
This is the story of a brave soul.
Hello, sir.
Get out of here.
Who is trying to find his destiny.
Can I learn how to work the sheep today?
Get him up, pig.
Remember, you have to dominate them. Bend them to your will.
He knew his path would not be easy.
I'm not sure if you realize how much the other animals are laughing at you.
It's not a duck that thinks it's a rooster. It's a pig that thinks it's a dog.
You should accept what he is and be thankful for it.
But now he's determined.
They're sheep. They're inferior.
Oh, no, they're not.
To take care of business.
All a nice little pig like you need do is ask.
His way.
Thanks very much. It was very kind of you.
A pleasure.
What a nice little pig.
From Universal Pictures comes the story of Babe.
You look like an intelligent, sophisticated, discerning young fella.
Who, me?
The pig with the gift of gab.
La, la, la.
Nerves of steel.
Get out of here, you big buttheads.
And a heart.
May I call you Mom?
Of gold. Babe.
I mean, let's really talk about why this movie succeeded more than the previous pig film we got this year, Gordy did. Right off the bat, you really like these characters a lot. They do a really good job of using the animatronics from Jim Henson's Creature Shop, and the talking animal effects are done by Rhythm and Hughes, who have done a ton of visual effects work over the years. And the way these animals' mouths move, the way they move with the story, just works a whole lot better in Gordy. In this movie, you don't hate anybody... everybody in this movie like you did with Gordy. I mean, Gordy just was a mess of a film on so many levels, but this is a simple film. It's a simple film with a simple concept. A talking pig wants to be a sheepdog so it could stay alive. I mean, pretty much this pig is fighting for his life as every day if he doesn't do something important to this farm, he's basically one step closer to being on the menu for a holiday dinner or something like that. But, it's also just it's a simple movie. It's a really simple storyline to work with, but one that has a lot of heart and enjoyment to it. Like, you really do like these characters a lot, and they're voiced very well by all these notable actors and actresses of different forms. Like you'll notice some of the names in here. Like, you've definitely heard their name. You may not have heard their names, but you've definitely heard their voices before. Like, the big name is, of course, Christine Cavanaugh, who does the voice of Babe, and, of course, she's known as the voice of Chucky from most of the early years of the Rugrats, and also the early years of Dexter's Laboratory. She's also been on The Critic. She's been on a lot of shows in the past. And you also have Hugo Weaving from The Matrix, Miriam Flynn from Christmas Vacation, Lucy Taylor's a prolific voice actress. You've heard these voices before, and they're here in this movie, and... The human actors are great, too. I mean, James Cromwell is fantastic as the farmer in this, as well as Magda Subansky, I think I'm pronouncing the name right, as his wife. And there is just so much there to really appreciate about this movie. There's just so much of a charm to it. The music is very well done. There's nice direction by Chris Noonan. It has this nice, gorgeous visual look to it. It's very funny. It's a nice, warm-hearted film. It really does a lot there that just really just sticks with you after so many years. Like, the visuals in this movie just still stand out after all these years. It's an amazing, amazing movie, and I can't recommend it enough. I know, and, you know, it made for a really good movie, which actually led to a sequel that surprisingly is a lot better than many people would expect it to be. And then you also realize that this is also produced by George Miller, best known for the Mad Max movies, but it feels a lot like the same way that the same thing that happened a couple years, is almost a decade after that, when he made Happy Feet and also Happy Feet 2, which are really good movies, especially the first one. Second one, not so much, but it does have one of my favorite movie scenes in it. And, I mean, it's kind of that same aspect here. Like, you definitely get a sense there. I would even say it's kind of similar to the Paddington movies, kind of. Paddington was one of those big surprises that really came out of nowhere, and they made a sequel that's actually a lot better than the original film, even though the original film is a great film. You could definitely say the same thing with this movie in particular. Babe just really is a great classic film. It's a movie that just holds up after so many years. And it's just an amazing, amazing film. It's just an amazing film that still holds up after all these years. And a fun fact here, the song in the movie, If I Had Words, like, it's notably sung by the mice in this movie, but if you listen to that song really closely, and then you go back to where the original song came from, which I have the, I had it here for a second, here it is. The names of the people that sing it, Scott Fitzgerald and Yvonne Keeley, if you go back and look at that music video, and then you listen to the song at the end of the credits for Babe, you'll notice that the original song is actually just, it's just slowed down. But when you listen to the one in the film, it's just a faster version of that song. And I'm going to show you that right now. Now, I knew this because I actually changed the pitch on it from the normal pitch on YouTube to 1.5. I think it was 1.5, but if you listen to that 1.5 version, you could definitely hear it's the same version as the one in Babe. Take a listen for yourself. Yeah, I didn't even notice that until just a couple of years ago when I did a review for it for the website, and I just realized that that song had pretty much just a sped up version of the original song, which is actually much slower, has sort of a reggae beat to it, and it works on both levels. Like, it works as a slow song, but it also works as a faster paced song after it's almost 20 years later. And yeah, what more can I say about Babe? It's just a great film that still holds up after so many years. So with that said, let us move on to the next movie, and that is Denzel Washington and Russell Crowe starring in Virtuosity.
In this high-tech crime prevention facility, one man has been recruited to play a simulated game. The objective: to hunt down the ultimate virtual reality killer, Sid 6.7. There's only one problem. The computer changed the program. Now, he's in the real world.
He's interactive.
On your knees, now!
He doesn't enjoy the game unless he's playing against his favorite opponent, and that's me.
From the director of Lawnmower Man.
He's recreating mass murders.
So you're saying Sid's a copycat?
Sid 6.7 is intent on improving the original.
Denzel Washington.
Just because I'm carrying around the joy of killing your family inside me doesn't mean we can't be friends.
Virtuosity. Game over.
Of course you get the director of Lawnmower Man to do a movie about a killer straight from the computer. And it's another one of those movies that we got in 95 where the computer was the enemy, or the computer was part of the major storyline. We've already talked about several movies that were very much like this. I'd probably say it's the best of the ones that we've looked at for the most part so far. One of the best, at least. But it really isn't saying a whole lot because this movie isn't all that great. And I think it's one of those movies where it works. There's where it works is in the two leads. Denzel Washington, I think, does what he does best in this movie. He actually rewrote a lot of this story and dialogue while they were filming. They took out a whole subplot about him falling in love with a doctor character played by Kelly Lynch. They actually took that out of the movie, and it was basically because Washington basically rewrote the script there. But I think the person that's really having the most fun in this movie is Russell Crowe. Like, he's having a good time playing this bad guy, this virtual reality kill assassin. And he really does have a lot of the fun and moments in the movie. Like, you could tell he's having the time of his life with this film. But as far as everything else goes, it definitely looked like they were trying to do something similar to Lawnmower Man, and that's why they brought in the same director. But there just really wasn't a good twist at the end or a good third act surprise to really give it its own unique distinctive look. But like I said before, it's not a bad film. I mean, Denzel Washington and Russell Crowe really are saving the film. But other than that, though, it's just a mostly forgettable film. If you want to see a better Denzel Washington and Russell Crowe film, go watch American Gangster. That's a film that's way better on so many levels. And it's a great film. It's probably one of the best movies from the decade of the 2000s. But other than that, Virtuosity is kind of a mixed bag film. Most people don't like it. I think Denzel and Russell Crowe really do keep it afloat for a movie that's passable, but nothing really all that spectacular. So, with that said, let us go on to the next movie, and that is Daniel Stern in the comedy Bushwhacked.
We got a fugitive on the loose here, people! He's armed, he is dangerous, and he's got himself some hostages!
Kind of cut the trail a little short there, but Bushwhacked is one of those movies that was notoriously known for not being all that great, but it was actually something that originally started off as a spinoff to Home Alone. It was actually going to be Daniel Stern's Marv character who had been reformed and actually gets involved in this adventure, which could have been something very interesting, but unfortunately the movie just doesn't really make a whole lot of sense after that, because when you really look at this movie and see what could have been, it definitely wouldn't have fit what they were going to go with here. And I won't say that the movie is downright terrible. I think it does have some moments in there where it's like, okay, there's definitely some parts here that I did get a good chuckle out of, but other than that, though, there's nothing really all that funny about it. And the trailer, I think, really does have pretty much sums up why it didn't work, because it's trying to be like a mix between what was popular 2 years ago. You had The Fugitive and The Cliffhanger in that one little trailer there, and I don't know. I just didn't think it worked all that well. And I think it's a film that really had a lot of potential. If they had gone with the original intention where it was going to be Marv in this role instead of somebody else, I don't really think it could have worked as well as they thought it would have. And it doesn't work as well as it does here. It's just kind of like, it's not that great of a film. But at the same time, it's one that I saw when I was a kid. So part of me does have a little bit of that nostalgic edge to it, so maybe I'm to give it more of a pass than any person usually would. It's not a good movie by any means, but it's definitely, I've seen far worse compared to this. It's just like, it's there, it's nothing all that special, but like I said, I've seen a whole lot worse, so. So that is Bushwhacked. Let's move on to the next movie, and that is Steven Weber starring in Jeffrey.
Jeffrey, you are being ridiculous.
Can you tell if you're having a nervous breakdown?
This sex thing has got completely out of hand.
Dad, I've stopped having sex.
Jeff stopped having sex.
No sex? You mean just safe sex.
My dear, what you need is a relationship.
A relationship? And shoes.
Steve.
Jeffrey.
Jeff. You had a boyfriend, then you could relax.
How about phone sex?
What? Jeffrey, you're beginning to have a problem.
Oh, Fred, let's help him out. Sweetheart, what are you wearing?
Jeffrey, listen to reason!
Dad, I'm not gonna have phone sex with you and Mom.
Jeffrey!
Oh, and what about this person, Steve?
Oh.
From the first second I saw you, I fantasized about you, letting you do things to me that I have only committed with 5,000 other men.
I mean, Jeffrey, it's just sex.
You know, in a better world, I could ask you to square dance.
Oh, look, a wholesome gay couple.
Just so there's no surprises, I'm HIV positive.
You should have told me.
I did.
Well, sooner, before things happen.
Oh, before I kissed you.
Yeah. And I'm sorry, that life is suddenly radioactive. Of course life sucks. It always will, so why not make the most of it? How dare you not lunge for any shred of happiness?
How about tomorrow night?
I'm working until 10.
Afterwards.
Well, oh, come on. You're gay, you're single.
It isn't pretty.
Yes!
Yes!
Table for two?
It's my decision. I get to be Jeffrey.
Oh. What do you want?
Jewelry.
I don't know about anybody else, but I think that trailer really did not sell this movie well. It felt like a trailer that was just all over the place. There was nothing really all that amazing about it. But it does sound more promising than the trailer actually gives it credit for. I mean, this movie, basically the premise is that it takes place in Manhattan during the height of the AIDS epidemic and revolves around this character, Jeffrey, played by Steven Weber, who's a gay man who has sworn off sex because of what was going on. And if it is not so much that Jeffrey is afraid of dying himself, but that he is afraid that he'll fall in love with someone who is bound to die. Thus, his celibacy is not only about sex, but also relationships in general. Almost immediately after that, he meets a guy named Steve, who is an HIV-positive man, and he experiences an emotional conflict as he must face his fear in order to accept love, often breaking the fourth wall to do so. With the help of his friends, an interior decorator played by Patrick Stewart, his partner Darius, as well as a cast of cameos including Nathan Lane and Sigourney Weaver, and he's basically able to overcome his fears and begin a relationship with the Steve character. I haven't seen the movie, so that's why I kind of ran down the plot there, because I really didn't know too much about it until I did the research on it, but it's written by Paul Rudnick, who had done the Addams Family movies. Christopher Ashley is a name that I think I'm familiar with, but I'm not too sure. I'm trying to look at his biography here. I don't think I know. I've heard the name before. I just have not seen any other of his works before, so I can't really say anything on that front here. But the premise alone sounds pretty interesting, and I just think that trailer didn't do it any favors by selling it. I don't think it did well at the box office, but it did well critically. It got some decent awards, and everybody thinks Patrick Swayze should have gotten some awards consideration for his role in this movie, and he does look like he's having a good time in that role. So, yeah, I mean, this definitely could be something very interesting. Like, it could be a very funny movie, but, man, like I said, that trailer did not do it any favors. So, again, can't really say too much more about Jeffrey because I haven't seen it, so why don't we go ahead and wrap it up with the last movie that we have here, and that is Unzipped.
You're a little close.
Jesus,
curls here.
Last season, the fashion world slammed his collection.
Isaac Mizrahi's show was a mess.
Don't show these things to me.
Now, to make his comeback, he's hired the best talent in the business for the fashion event of the year.
I'm not that stressed out.
We have a very big day tomorrow.
I hate when people tell me I'm stressed out.
Let's go!
When the music comes on, and the stars come out, what happens on stage is almost as outrageous as what's going on backstage.
It has to be the most wonderful 20 minutes of a designer's life.
Oh, Naomi, that's coming out.
And there are girls changing from behind the screen, which you can see through.
See us in bras and underwear?
Maybe.
Are they
going to
want to do that?
No.
No.
We really do see everything.
Oh, yes.
Everything!
You show me the pose and
I'll... It's the movie the New York Times proclaims hilarious. And Entertainment Weekly calls wickedly funny. Take an undercover peek behind the scenes.
That thing is in my bed all the time, sweetie.
And behind the screens.
Wait a minute.
At the most beautiful women in the world.
Hit it, baby.
In the film Rolling Stone calls the best party movie of the year. The Wild. Weird.
I'm thick under my skirt.
Wonderful world of fashion.
You just made fashion history.
Unzipped.
Is it worth it? It's always worth it. Even when it sucks, it's worth it.
So no joke, when I watched the trailer for this, I thought I was re-reviewing a different version of Preta Porter, the Robert Altman movie from last year that took place around Paris Fashion Week. Was a movie that was not a big success whatsoever, and I thought that this was that same movie again, just with a different title. But it's a much different movie. It's a documentary that follows fashion designer Isaac Mizrahi, who is a name that I've heard of. I don't know exactly what he's been behind, like what kind of stuff he's made, but I've seen his name in department stores like Macy's and Kaufman's when that used to be around. And I definitely know who he is, but I just don't know what kind of stuff he made. But the movie basically follows him, and as he was the then boyfriend of this director, Douglas Keeve, who made the documentary, and it basically plans and ultimately shows his 1994 collection. And the film notoriously put a riff in the relationship of him and the director that they eventually broke up after it came out. And there's also appearances by Cindy Crawford, Naomi Campbell, Linda Evangelista, Kate Moss, and so you see Richard Gere in there as well, as Liza Minnelli, Eartha Kitt, other celebrities and designers from the fashion world and beyond. And that's really all I know about the film because I haven't seen it, but like I said, I thought it was the same movie I looked at last time, but it's a much different film. It's a documentary, and it's got some decent reviews for it, so it could be something good, but like I said, I can't really say too much about it because I haven't seen it, but it came out this weekend. Might as well bring it up, so that's pretty much all I've got on that one, so Unzipped. And on that note, we wrap up another edition of Time About the Movies. Next time, we'll take a look at four movies, including Michelle Pfeiffer in Dangerous Minds. We also have Keanu Reeves in A Walk in the Clouds, Disney's A Kid in King Arthur's Court, and also The Brothers McMullen, which I believe is the first film from Fox Searchlight, which was in other studio within 20th Century Fox that focused more on independent films. I believe that's the first film they've ever done. I could be wrong on that, but when I do some more research, I'll let you know tomorrow. But other than that, though, thank you very much for watching, and if you want to see more videos like this, please hit the playlist on the next page, check out the previous episode, and I will see you guys tomorrow for another episode. So, thank you for watching, I'll see you guys next time, and until then, as always, take care.